Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null. And I'll tell you so.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us today. We're going to talk about those energy drinks that are so popular that so many people consume every day. Harvard School of Public Health has done some research and how pomegranate extract alters breast cancer stem cell properties. That's good news. That's University of Albany. And how yerba mate, that was popular about 35, 40 years ago. Well, according to a new university in South Korea, it enhances cellular energy and metabolism. And there's a strain of intestinal bacteria that can stop high-salt diets from inducing inflammation. So this is from MIT. We'll also talk today about a study finding consuming nuts strengthens brainwave functions. So all those are important. Then we're going to look at some issues, and this will be our talk back. We're going to ask about questioning everything. It's a short piece. George Carlin's in it. And then a different approach to the history of consumerism and public relations. This is one of the most articulated and accurate summations of how did we get to where so many people are making so many bad choices on a day-to-day basis. So we'll be sharing that with you. And then the question is, and this is a follow-over from yesterday, I'll also be doing The Age of Anger, a short commentary from Chris Hedges. Are we capable, not will we, are we capable at this time, with all the conditioning from our parents and those who wanted the best for us, to really make authentic change? Or are we just aware enough, if we're smart enough, to realize that what we're doing or what society is doing is not in its best interest or the planet or for human beings, but we do not have the personal integrity to do it. We're lacking the discipline, we're lacking the support system, we're lacking the originality of ideas, especially since the originality of ideas pours forth from your ability to be proactive, and we are a very passive society. That's what technology has done. So even though we know the problems, and there are myriad and many, it doesn't mean that we will do anything at all to change them. At least I'm only referring now to the majority of people. I'm not referring to those people who are very proactive, very concerned, very conscientious, and doing a lot of good. But no one's paying attention to them. They're considered the other. They've been pushed to the margins. And hence, even though if they could cure cancer or if they could show how to stop pollution, they wouldn't be taken seriously, because we do not share power in any paradigm. Power is absolute, and therefore paradigms don't change. People can change, but the paradigm is the brand. And therefore, if you're Catholic, it doesn't matter how Catholicism could evolve and change to meet modern times and modern needs. It won't. It can't. That's not possible. You may have a nice pope, and you certainly do. I think he's a genuinely humane and kind and thoughtful and intelligent person. And if he happens to have views like on the environment, which he does, that are very good, good. But will he then encourage or demand that there be women involved as priests and change a lot of the old historical ritualized beliefs? No. No, you can have good people in bad brands. You can have bad people running bad brands, and that's what we now have with our body politic. So I'm going to be asking you questions, and I'm going to open a lot of time today, about 20 minutes, for you to answer. Hopefully you will, but if you don't, then I have a lot of material to share with you. So let's begin. I believe that if you want a real energy drink, a glass of orange juice, glass of apple juice, those are real energy drinks. Pomegranate juice, grape juice, outstanding energy drinks, because they provide you with all natural polyphenols and natural fructose, the fructose that comes as nature intended. I'll never forget in one of my dietetics classes, I'm also a registered dietitian, but when I was studying to become a registered dietitian, everyone in the room was overweight, and the information that we were being taught was just wrong. But nobody would change anything, and so one day there was this issue, and the issue was, if you're a dietitian working in a hospital, the doctor tells you what the patient's diet should be, then it's your responsibility to create the food or all the nutritional intake of the patient. So if they want a certain amount of fat, you don't care where the fat comes from. It could come from soybean oil or palm oil. You're certainly not going to come from olive oil or coconut oil. And if they need a certain amount of calories, you just load up with sugar. It didn't matter if it's just white fructose, because at that point when I was going to school, white fructose was considered just normal sugar. Nothing wrong with it. So I asked in the class, I said, if you have an apple and you have 2 teaspoons of sugar in natural fructose form and you have 2 teaspoons of white sugar, which one would you give the patient? Now, I'm asking this as a student in the class. And this particular professor, Dr. Berman, said, it wouldn't matter. They're both the same. And I said, well, there's a big difference. He said, no, there's not. I said, well, let me share my thoughts and then see if this makes any sense. I said, in the sugar that's refined, you're going to spike the blood sugar level. You're going to see this roller coaster up and down real quick. That sugar might give energy, but the energy is only going to be for about 3 minutes. Whereas if you eat an apple, it has fiber. The fiber slows down the absorption of the sugar. It has a low glycemic index. And the sugars are natural. They haven't been processed. There's nothing wrong with processed sugar. I said, well, I would share a difference of opinion. Have you seen how sugar is processed? What do you mean? Have you gone to any of the places that make our sugar to actually see what goes on? He said, no. I said, well, I have. And here's what it happens. This is true in Barbados. It's true in Trinidad. It's true in Jamaica. I've been to all three. Went to the sugar plantations. First, you start off with sugar, cane sugar. Now, if you want to know why so many cane workers have rotten teeth and all forms of gum disease and gingivitis, it's because they're chewing on that because it has a sweetness. It's not high sweet, and therefore you have to take a lot of it in order to get the satisfaction, the satiety of sweetness. It's about 50, somewhere around above 56, 57% sweetness. Not like pure sugar. I said, but they're chewing on that throughout the day. Otherwise, there are minerals in there. There are enzymes in there. But you'd have to take that in very small amounts. So when that sugar is cut, it goes through a grinding process with these giant claws, crush it up. And once it's crushed up, the liquid that was inside, the sap of inside the sugar cane, drops out and goes into catch bins. And these catch bins then funnel it into a large container. And when you look at it, it's very brown. It's very turbid, meaning it has a lot of particulate matter in it. And you can see into it, but they don't want that. So they dry that out. And when they dry it out, they then press it into blocks. And these blocks look like bricks. Now, that is what was the original turbinado sugar. It's still sugar, but it has the minerals, the enzymes, the vitamins, the phytonutrients, and fibers in there. For example, it just won't dissolve 100%. You'll see particulate matter. But generally, that is not sold in the United States. Instead, they have to put a lye, a bleach in it, in effect, and they then purify it. They heat it at high temperature. They purify it. So what comes out, and it's actually a shot out of a tube into a giant room, and they actually used a bulldozer to scoop it up and put it into machines or to be bagged. And I said, so what a difference. So there's stages of which sugar becomes the white crystallized sugar that we see versus a crude sugar. Now, anytime you see organic cane juice, that means that at the point where it was crushed, where the sugar cane was crushed, that juice came out. That's actually not bad, providing you don't use a lot of it, but it's fine. And it's not been processed. It doesn't have any of the chemicals in it. But that's not generally what we're using in our society. So after I explained all that, after class, he said, don't ever ask a question again in this class. I said, why not? He said, because that interferes with the information I'm giving, and it contradicts the information that's in that textbook that you're using. But what if the textbook is wrong? He said, the textbook's not wrong. So I didn't say anything else. I just said, okay, you don't want questions, I want to ask questions. But in my world, you question everything. When someone sent me an email this morning, and it was a thoughtful email about why don't I look into the geoengineering. In point of fact, I did a whole hour program on geoengineering, but with a very qualified person. In fact, they had sent me a video to watch. I'd already watched it. I'd already interviewed the person, a whole hour on it. And then they responded that, but why don't you get into the pizza pedophilia and the Illuminati? And I said, because I do not have the evidence to support those claims. And those who put them forward, like Alex Jones, were found wrong and had to apologize. I said, we actually believe in scholarship. And that scholarship means that we don't just take a headline and run with it. We originate stories. Over 300 original investigative reporting stories. And in that reporting, you question everything. Because more often than not, if you don't question, you're going to be taken advantage of. And we're going to get to that in a moment of how we've been taken advantage of, especially when it comes to nutritional science. And the honesty of Wikipedia, which is not honest at all. By the way, anyone in this audience that has worked as an editor for Wikipedia, I'd like to hear your stories, because I am of the opinion that Wikipedia has been substantially influenced by people working with the pharmaceutical industry as well as the CIA. That's input I've had from very qualified sources. In fact, some 200 editors were fired because of that, and they have selective biases. So no matter how wrong they are, corrections will never happen. And so anyone who has information on Wikipedia, send it to prnstudio@gmail.com, prnstudio@gmail.com. I'd like to know what it is, because everyone that I've spoken to who's in the world of health or vaccine challenges is vilified on there, and every time they go to change the inaccuracies, immediately it's changed back. So it's just another form of fake information. Some may be accurate, a lot of it is not. So in any case, the whole idea is we better start questioning everything. So just to assume that because someone says something about the Illuminati or child pornography, and I did a whole hour special 2 weeks ago on the Progressive Commentary on child pedophilia. But it was from a scholar. It was from a lawyer and a PhD on the topic who had done meticulous research, who presented their information at the United Nations, and who are actively involved over 20 years. And yes, it's true. Pedophilia exists. In fact, I can tell you this. I hope within the next 6 months that the two biggest names in Hollywood who have not been mentioned to date, these are not actors. These are not directors or producers. These are not head like the guy challenged yesterday from the one of the top people at the William Morris Agency, which at one time was my agency, Mel Berg. In fact, he was a terrific agent, and he ushered in what would be, I think, 16 bestsellers in a row. And when I was a member of it, and it may be even today, it was a very good agency, but evidently the head of its whole film division went over at a party and groped the genitals of Terry Crews, the actor and football player, and now he's filed suit against him. But listen to this. He did it at a party, packed party. He did it repeatedly. Here's the question. What is the likelihood that a person does this who's not drunk, unless he's done it so many times and gotten away with it in a culture that accepts it? Because if you're the head of an agency, you can write a ticket for someone's career. You, the agent, decides who's going to get into a movie, who's going to direct a movie, who's going to produce a movie. They control all of Hollywood. So watch what happens once one of these people is called out. Then someone's going to say, well, they've been doing this their whole career. You mean 20 years in this city? Los Angeles is just it's a cesspool of corruption and special interest and careerism and narcissism. But the two biggest names, let me go on the record, the two biggest names engaged in pedophilia have yet to be outed. Let's see if someone does it. If they don't, then I will probably do it. But I'm going to give it a period of time and let those who were the victims do it. That will shock a lot of people because you don't think it goes that high. It starts at that level of high because the more power you have, the more you can control everyone else below you, especially if they need something from you. So that's that. Anyhow, the health risks associated with these energy drinks, according to Harvard School of Public Health and published in Frontiers in Public Health, it's substantial. They claim you're going to get some short-term energy. Yeah, you do. But now they're seeing behavioral problems, mental health problems, increased blood pressure, obesity, kidney damage, all that from these energy drinks. And they're growing worldwide. So you should be warned. You take your risk when you drink an energy drink that's not a natural energy drink. Quote, we summarize the consequences of energy drink consumption, which include heart, kidney, and dental problems, as well as risk-seeking behavior and poor mental health. The evidence suggests that they are harmful to health and should be limited through more stringent regulations by restricting their sales to children and adolescents, as well as setting an evidence-based upper limit on the amount of caffeine. By the way, what's actually in an energy drink? More often than not, it's just water, sugar, and caffeine. That's the big majority. They may sprinkle a tiny little amount of vitamins and mineral in it, and maybe some ginseng, and then try to make it look like you're getting a ginseng drink. You're not. When you're taking in 100 milligrams per fluid ounce, and an average, that's 8 times more than a regular cup of coffee. And let's say that you have 400 to 800 milligrams of caffeine in a day, you're putting yourself really at risk of a heart attack. So the energy, it's a $10 billion a year industry, but it's very responsible. Now, something is very responsible is taking pomegranates. Now, you can eat the pomegranates. You can get them frozen or organic, so you can have them any time of the year. You can get concentrates, which are good. But here's what they do. They can alter breast cancer stem cell properties. They also do a lot of other things. They can help repair and the damage to the intima, the inner lining, the epithelial tissue in the arteries, hence lowering the risk of a stroke or heart attack. But according to the University at Albany, a team has found evidence suggesting that the same antioxidant that gives pomegranate fruit that vibrant red color can alter the characteristics of breast cancer stem cells, showing the superfood's potential for aiding in much more than diabetes or heart disease as previously thought. Why? Pomegranate extract is derived mainly from the skin of the fruit, and it's known for having high levels of powerful antioxidants called polyphenols. And these polyphenols are extremely beneficial, and they also help fight cancer. And because not all cancer cells are the same, and tumors are comprised of many types of cells, they decided to target the one long thought to be the most dangerous in any given tumor, the cancer stem cells. Now, just a little, I'll make it as non-technical as possible, but this is the future, by the way. this is the future of functional foods and nutritional medicine, because we now know that based upon the concentration of different nutrients, like concentration of chlorophyll, and chlorophyll is not just green, it can be red, it can be brown, be yellow, but the concentration of chlorophyll can actually create new healthy stem cells and hence help reverse the aging process and repair damage to different organs. But stem cells are unlike other types of cells in that they have a remarkable ability to self-divide and reproduce themselves, even giving rise to other types of cells. And this self-dividing nature alone is not dangerous. In fact, normal tissue stem cells can replace dying cells and even repair damaged tissue. The danger arises if stem cells become cancer stem cells, because their division and renewing ability carries over to cancer progression by aiding in tumor initiation and growth and even reinitiating cancerous tumors long after a person has been declared cancer-free. So compounding these issues are the fact that cancer stem cells are thought to be more resistant to therapy than other types of cancer cells. As such, cancer stem cells have become an important target in cancer therapy and prevention, more so than other cancer cells, because the idea that if the stem cell can be slowed or made less stem-like, the cancer itself could be slowed down. So together with some researchers, they conducted experiments using cancer cell lines that are the prototypes of breast cancer stem cells. And these cells, which display the exact properties of cancer stem cells, were treated with diluted pomegranate concentrate and incubated for periods ranging from 1 to 6 days. Now, during this time, the team measured several markers of breast cancer stem cells in both the pomegranate extract treated cells and the untreated cells. They then compared the results between the groups and observed significant differences between the cancer stem cell prototypes that were treated with pomegranate extract. Now, traditionally, the cells that were treated with pomegranate extract were treated with relatively small amounts, thought to be manageable for a person to consume by simply purchasing, let's say, some pomegranate or pomegranate juice. And this is what they said. They said that, quote, "One thing we found surprising is that relatively low concentrations of the extract are able to modify the ability of cancer stem cells to reproduce themselves." Good news. You're stopping the cancer stem cells from reproducing or from generating cancer. And pomegranate extract inhibited breast cancer cells to self-renew, and the inhibitory effect is maintained for several cell generations of newly formed cells, the equivalent to children and grandchildren of pomegranate extract exposed parent cells that have never been exposed to pomegranate extract but still have difficulty to self-renewing. It means it lasts. And pomegranate extract converts cancer cells, stem cells, to cells that look like more traditional cancer cells, which may be successfully killed. Quote, "Our evidence alone does not suggest that pomegranate is the end-all be-all cure of breast cancer, but pomegranate extract shows promising potential for having a positive effect in both the primary cancer prevention and inhibition of the disease progression." Good. And that's from Harvard. So, one more reason for those of you taking your pomegranate. Now, it's only in season once a year, and it's very messy. It's fun if you want to watch your hands, and it pops those little orbs in there when you're clearing them out of the pomegranate. They'll burst all over you, so it looks like little drops of blood all over your shirt. But get a cupful and have a cup of pomegranates a day. If you can't get it fresh, which most people cannot, then get it frozen and just thaw it and use it in your smoothie, or get a pomegranate concentrate. And finally, this is from MIT, and it talks about a strain of intestinal bacteria that can stop high-salt diets from inducing inflammation. And you don't want that inflammation, because that inflammation leads to high blood pressure, which leads to strokes and leads to death. It's all about the little microbes living in your gut that can help protect against the effects of a high-salt diet. So the MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology team, working with researchers in Germany, found that in both mice and humans, a high-salt diet shrinks the population of a certain type of beneficial bacteria. As a result, pro-inflammatory immune cells, called Th17, grow in number, and these immune cells have been linked with high blood pressure. The researchers showed that treatment with a probiotic could reverse these effects. So let's start taking more of the high-quality probiotics into our diet. I suggest for an average person on a daily basis, 10 billion. You can get that in one teaspoon. For those of you who have candida, or yeast infections, low immune system, who have antibiotic resistance, who've taken antibiotic, 100 billion a day. Oh, and by the way, from Loma Linda University, published in the FASEB Scientific Journal, they found that eating nuts on a daily basis strengthens the brain wave frequencies associated with healing, cognition, learning, memory, and other key brain functions. So, very important to have some fresh nuts or nut butters each day into your diet. If we have people in this audience who are taking antidepressants, and you want to look at something you've not heard of before, look at canna, K-A-N-N-A, canna. And it's an herbal medicine that has a strong scientifically documented background, but nobody really knows about it. And it's the African-based plant, the canna. It's scientifically classified as, I'll spell this for you, S-C-E-L-E-T-I-U-M-T-O-R-T-U-O-S-U-M. And it has a calming, yet euphoric quality that's akin to the traditional sedative herbs like cannabis or daga or sereta. But unlike cannabis, canna is totally unregulated. And so something that you didn't know, now you do, and that can help you. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting out of the city. We're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. Nice to have you with us. We are a world right now that is confused, and rightly so. Think of how many people don't know when the next tsunami is coming, earthquake, wildfire, hurricane, tornado. People in some parts of the world don't know where they're going to have their next meal. We have 1 billion plus people who are food insecure. We have 17 million children in the United States who go to bed each day. They didn't have a full meal that day. In some cases, the best meal they're going to get is the one that the school provides them in the morning. We have a body politic that most reasonable and all progressives would agree is completely corrupted and is not capable of being reformed. If you want the best example of the Trojan horse of politics, look at Bernie Sanders. He will still become the good Democrat. He will stay the good Democrat, and he'll try to get the more idealist in the millennial group to vote for him, but that's just leading them all into that same pantheon of total corruption that is the Democratic system. We need multiple parties. We need a Labor Party. We need a Progressive Party. We need parties other than the Justice Party and the Green Party. And though the Green Party has done its best, and I voted for Ralph Nader, and and Rocky Anderson and Jill Stein, those are good people, but they don't have the it factor. And also, I don't think they comprehended just having the truth is not enough. It's never been enough because of our conditioning. So people are angry, angry at the fact that they were at a birthday party, a wedding party, or funeral, and suddenly from nowhere came drones and killed their family members. They don't understand. There are places in the world that used to be lush with vegetation that are not today. They're barren landscapes because someone wanted to exploit the natural resources but didn't care about what happened to the people or the environment after it was exploited. These are barren scars ripped from Mother Earth as if it has no feelings. We have created environmental immigrants. We've created political immigrants by our wars. And yet people are angry, and they know that nothing will change, not for the better, not for them. Chris Hedges also understands anger. I'm going to play a piece about him that he did on tomorrow's show. But when we look at anger, we have to also look at the nihilism and the rage sweeping across the globe that are not generated by warped ideologies or medieval religious beliefs. These destructive forces have their roots in the obliterating of social and cultural and religious traditions by modernization in the consumer society. The disastrous attempts by the United States to carry out regime change, often through coups and wars and utopian neoliberal ideology that has concentrated wealth in the hands of a tiny cabal of corrupt global oligarchs. And to give you an idea of the consequences, I'm going to ask Jesse in New York if you have available the short piece I sent you this morning from CNN. I want to play that if you have it, about people for sale, where lives are auctioned for $400 per person. These were people who were made homeless. These were people who could no longer live in their environment, so they wanted to come to an environment where they have a chance to raise a family. And in the process of having that done, they were taken captive, and they were sold. Listen to this short clip. It's only 49 minutes, seconds long. This is from CNN, and this is not being attributed the way it should be. Here's what it is.
I was there. The pushman that put me from there, I gave him money, did not pay. So they said, since he's not paid, he did not pay that money. Then I sold me. I was there. The person who came to buy me gave the man money. They asked me to pay money. So probably must have been there for like 3 months. They will start beating you. From a week, they will start beating you so that your money will come quickly. So I was there for 8 months before I could pay my money and I went out. If you look at most of the people here, if you check their body, you see the mark, they're beating. With electric, even your boot, or they took something like a sharp object. Understand? Most of them lost their life there. Many are dying every day. No phone call. Their family will be thinking that that person is dead. He has lost his whole life. Know that he's just in one place suffering. Going back home now, I'm totally frustrated.
I don't know what you're hearing. I realize it's a little difficult, but the CNN anchor comes in a moment. The CNN anchor is in Northern Africa, in Libya, and the man is explaining how he was beaten, how he had electrical rods attached to him, and he was sold. But then they find that all these people in this one building, all these men are being sold. And just like the old slave trade, they're brought out, they're stripped down, and buyers will buy them. Maybe they want to have them on a farm to do farm work. Now, once these people are sold, they don't get any money. They're now in a modern version of the old slavery trade. Now, this is in what country? A country that would never allow slavery, that was the most open and liberated as far as it's accepting multiple cultures, multiple tribes, multiple religions, the most progressive type of religious and tolerance in Africa. Muslim women had more freedom in this country, Libya, than any other country in the world. Now, Libya, which was the Paris of Africa, is now having open sale of slaves. This man was from Nigeria, which used to have people come to Libya because there was healthier working conditions, better pay. They would not be abused. They would not be have their passports confiscated. That is not the case in Dubai. All those wonderful and beautiful buildings, and there are certainly some of the best architecture in the world in Dubai, all that was from slave labor. The same with Abu Dhabi. These are both part of the United Arab Emirates, but so true would be in Saudi Arabia, in Kuwait and Qatar. They all use these slave laborers. But now, Gaddafi would never allow that, and now you have it. So what's the takeaway message? For Hillary Clinton, and what irony of ironies, the man who won the Nobel Peace Prize but caused more Americans to be imprisoned or to be tried for this old and archaic Espionage Act of 1917, Barack Obama. But now Barack Obama is directly and personally and morally responsible for black Africans being sold as slaves in a completely failed country. Went from the top 54, number one, to the bottom. All because of regime change. That's happening right now. Do you hear anyone talking about it? Or the consequences? Or going to all those neoliberals on radio, including on Pacifica, and saying, you promoted regime change in Libya. You promoted regime change in Syria. Thank goodness Russia intervened, so Syria is still Syria. But look at Libya. It is not. So what we have is we have a vast global project of social engineering during the last century, persuading hundreds of millions of people to renounce and often scorn a world of the past that had endured for thousands of years. And that project has been a spectacular failure. Who was it? Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who said, to destroy the people, you must sever their roots. And it was France Fanon who talked about the wretched of the earth. They have been shorn of any ideological or cultural cohesion. They are cut off from their past. They live in crushing poverty, numbing alienation, hopelessness, and often terror. And mass culture feeds them the tawdry, the violent, the salacious, and the ridiculous. So Western elites, the people running our world, rather than accept their responsibility for the global anarchy and self-serving clash that is occurring of our values, of the so-called enlightened West and the medieval barbarians, they see in the extreme nationalists and religious fundamentalists and jihadists all in cahoots and inexplicable irrationality that can be quelled only by force. They have yet to grasp that the disenfranchised do not hate us for our values. They hate us because of our duplicity, the use of indiscriminate industrial violence on their nations and communities, in our hypocrisy. The dispossessed grasp the true message of the West to the rest of the world. We have everything, and if you try to take away from us, we will kill you. The more the Western elites are attacked, the more they too retreat into a mythological past of self-glorification and willful ignorance. And nationalism, more than ever before, a mystification, if not a dangerous fraud, with its promise of making a country great again, and its demonization of the other, it conceals the real conditions of existence and the true origins of suffering, even as it seeks to replicate the comforting balm of transcendental ideals within a bleak earthy horizon. The proponents of globalization, That would be every single president, including Jimmy Carter, promised to lift workers across the planet into the middle class. They did not, just the opposite. The Democratic Party and the Republican Party joined hands in taking American jobs out of the United States. Over 30 million people have lost their jobs over the last 40 years. And what they talked about was their sense of democratic values and scientific rationalism. Religious and ethnic tensions would have been alleviated or eradicated, and this global marketplace would create a peaceful, prosperous community of nations. Yeah, tell that to the people that I spoke to in Camden, New Jersey, a city that once prospered because it was work. Now there's not, and they were forgotten. All we have to do, we were told, was get government out of the way and kneel before the market demands, held up by the ultimate form of progress and rationality. Well, friends, neoliberalism is the name of this absurd utopia, and it stripped away government regulations and laws that once protected the citizens from the worst excesses of predatory capitalism. Predatory capitalism is like predatory pedophilia. I have no more respect for the people of Wall Street than I would for a pedophile. In my opinion, they're one and the same. The difference is the pedophile strikes and brings their cursed mindset into the lives of innocent individuals, where Wall Street destroys whole continents with its greed. Look at Greece, and then look at Goldman Sachs. The people of Greece today are dumpster diving, living in poverty, dire poverty, and committing suicide in record numbers. And no one on Wall Street and no one at Goldman Sachs gave a damn. Yet we praise the people at Goldman Sachs, and we don't care about the people of the victims in Greece or any place else. So this is what we're dealing with. What we were never told was that the game was fixed. We were always condemned to lose. Our cities were deindustrialized and fell into decay. Wages declined. Our working class became impoverished. Endless wars became cynically and lucratively big business. And the world's wealth was seized by a tiny group of global oligarchs and kleptocrats. And now they're all installed in Washington, one giant toilet bowl overflowing with the vomit and excrement of Harvard, Yale. I condemn the Ivy League universities for what you have created. Not that every student is this way. They are not. But people pride themselves in using their moniker of where they graduated as the key to open the door for this greed to occur. These were the so-called best and brightest. You never hear of someone going to Washington from SUNY or from some state university, because that wouldn't get them in. Mass culture, including schools and the press, indoctrinated in our increasingly desperate population to take part in this vast global reality show of capitalism. And that's where we are today. And that's unfortunate. So when I said yesterday, take a good look at Germany, the irony of it is that everything that the German people did to the Jews, the Gypsies, the Blacks, and the Communists and Socialists, then when they were the victims of losing the war, the real victims then exercised extreme prejudice. And for at least a year, 12 million Germans, including German nationals, were dispossessed through an ethnic cleansing out of Poland and Czechoslovakia and other countries. Here was the problem. Not every German was a bad German or complicit German. But to the victors, every German was considered a bad German. There were no good Germans in their mindset. That kind of groupthink is dangerous. Those who were guilty should have been convicted and punished for their crimes against humanity. And because the Germans kept such meticulous records of everything they did, we knew who they were. But a lot of the people in the population did not support it, but were fearful of coming forward. Everybody was punished. Massive rapes, over 2 million women and children were raped, people murdered, and people put back into concentration camps had been emptied out. So the Jews were emptied out, skeletal, near death, and then the Germans were put in there and starved, frequently to death. We never hear about this part of history. So what do you think is the likely outcome in countries that have withstood decades of our abuse or others' abuse that we support? Do you not think that there will be a day of karmic reckoning? There will be, and that's unfortunate that we're not even aware of it. We're clueless about everything that's happening because we never question anything. Here's George Carlin telling us why we should question everything.
Judge a man by his questions rather than his answers. Voltaire.
That's the point completely. Not important to get children to read. Children who want to read are going to read. Kids who want to learn to read are going to learn to read. Much more important to teach children to question what they read. Children should be taught to question everything. To question everything they read, everything they hear. Children should be taught to question authority. Parents never teach their children to question authority because parents are authority figures themselves, and they don't want to undermine their own bit inside the household. Kids have to be warned that there's bullshit coming down the road. That's the biggest thing you can do for a kid. Tell them what life in this country is about. It's about a whole lot of bullshit that needs to be detected and avoided.
When you are aware, you can prepare. Our societal structure is broken. The Industrial Revolution took the father out of the house. The Consumer Revolution took the mother out of the house. It now takes two or three incomes to support a family now. Who is left to shape the minds of our children? Who benefits from this? Cui bono? Our society is mass-producing pathological narcissism on a massive scale. Fascination with fame and celebrity, fear of competition, the inability to suspend belief, shallowness and transitory quality of personal relationships. Who benefits from this? Collective power does. We know deep down that we are not getting ahead. We are presented with saviors who never change the system or solve the problems. Our future is not certain. My generation will be the first American generation to not live as well as the previous generation. This, unfortunately, has been designed to happen this way. We have been programmed all of our lives to shut out personal choices and conform with society. This could come in the form of a parent's authority, school's rules, social pressure, or the government laws and regulations. By the time we are adults, we have a self-regulating prison of our mind. We recognize the symptoms: self-doubt, low self-esteem, lack of motivation, and lack of original ideas. We think we know the cause of these problems: parents, education system, the media, the boss, etc. But in reality, they're just victims of the same dynamic.
I'm coming, bro!
Oh! Okay. Yeah. I don't know, you'll probably be about as good as I was. That's kind of the way it works, you know, and I was below average. You know, so you'll probably ultimately rank somewhere around there, you know, so I really, you'll excel at a lot of things, just not this. I don't want you out here shooting this ball around all day and night, all right?
All right.
Okay? All right, go ahead.
Society wants weak, dependent people because it gives power to those who run this world. If people were truly free and independent, they would have no need for any of the elite or collective thought. But the typical American is programmed through society to obey authority, follow the rules, and don't ask questions. We are to conform. We are programmed to go into debt with credit cards, student loans, mortgage, or car payments. The lower class is programmed to either depend on the government or work for the government. They eat fast foods to make them obese and diabetic. They see the military as a way out. Girls are programmed to get pregnant early. Politics is seen as a waste of time, and their lives are filled with distractions. The middle class is programmed to prepare for corporate jobs, to get into debt to have that American dream. Programmed to see objects as status and debt as a means to get that status. They excel at regurgitating information for academic achievement and talking points for financial or political intelligence. Corporate life breaks up the local support systems people have, driving a wedge between them and their roots. The system is perfectly designed for us to be just smart enough to run the machines and do the paperwork, but not smart enough to ask if this is really the best system for us.
Look around, look around. I see a lot of new faces. Shut up! Which means a lot of you have been breaking the first two rules of Fight Club.
Man, I see in Fight Club the strongest and smartest men who've ever lived. I see all this potential, and I see it squandered. God damn it, an entire generation pumping gas, waiting tables, slaves with white collars. Advertising has us chasing cars and clothes, working jobs we hate so we can buy what we don't need. We're the middle children of history, man. No purpose or place. We have no great war, no great depression. Our great war is a spiritual war. Our great depression is our lives. We've all been raised on television to believe that one day we'd all be millionaires and movie gods and rock stars, but we won't. We're slowly learning that fact. We're very, very pissed off.
Education is very dangerous. Every educated person is a future enemy. Hermann Göring. Making sure that you become free and independent does not serve the elites or anybody else's interest, so don't expect it. If you want it, you have got to fight for it.
Okay, now your turn. I'd like your views on how you've dealt with being a consumer. Are you doing things every day consciously so that you're not feeding that giant corporate machine out there? We all have to consume. There are certain things we must consume, but there's a lot of things we don't need. What are we doing individually and then hopefully collectively to break this power over our lives, this curse that we're living with of consumerism? 888-874-4888 is our number, 888-874-4888. Give a call now. I'd like to hear from you. And while we're waiting for your call to come in here, calls, hopefully, this Secretary of the Treasury and his Goldman parachute, I think he got $200 or $300 million, he was running a country where they foreclosed on a 90-year-old woman over 27 cents. 27 cents that was missing in what she paid. And they foreclosed. No heart, nothing. And that's a person running our treasury? Yeah, good luck with that. Also, one of the things that I believe we could do and should do to start showing the world we're no longer there to invade, to conquer, to maintain some form of control over the populations is to close all, I mean 100% of our military bases on foreign soil. I'm not alone in that. Margaret Flowers and Kevin Zeese have the same view, and I'll share just waiting for phone calls to come in right now. And we have one. We have Gwen from New York City. Hi, Gwen, your turn.
Hi, how are you, Gary?
Great, thank you.
I just wanted to say that I consider myself an expert at anti-consuming, because I know that there is so much stuff that people throw out. It's unbelievable the new and expensive things that people throw out. That when I go shopping now, I don't go to stores. I just go down the street, and I pretty much have gotten, my house is beautiful, and almost everything I have that I've gotten in my house is out of the trash, except for I won't take a mattress out of the trash. As far as furniture, I will not throw a couch out into the trash. It is not biodegradable, but I have a wonderful guy who comes and does my slipcovers. He's from the neighborhood. He's cheap. He only charged me $250 to recover my entire couch. So I think that what people, whatever your wants and needs are, they're really right in front of you. You just have to look. We've turned into a throwaway society, as I know you know, and it's devastating to the environment. And so I just feel like, why should I pay for stuff when I can get it for free and I'm doing a great thing for the environment and I have a beautiful home? I love my home and I love the things in it, and I know that I'm protecting the environment at the same time.
Good for you, Gwen. When I lived over on 84th and Riverside Drive in a brownstone, every morning when I would come out to go to run the park, there would be two different guys, one on one side of the street, one on the other. They had a shopping cart, and they would methodically open up all the bags of trash. They would pick out things, and they would close the bag back up. And I would stop, and I'd ask them, "What are you doing?" "Well, finding things." "What do you got there?" "Well, there was a radio that day, and and he said he could fix the radio. And what they would do, they would fix all of the things that they found that they could fix, take it up on Broadway, and sell it. So a radio that originally cost maybe $60, they would sell for $5.
And there's it money made, in that trash.
And they made enough money. They averaged about $60 a day. That was enough to provide them with an apartment. The two guys shared an apartment together, so making $120 a day average. And I thought, I said, well, can you sell books? They said, yes. So we get a ton of books, and my producers are always given books that people want to appear on the radio. So these are brand new books, and so I would get piles of them, like 50, 60 at a time, and give them to them to help them out. So just remember, things that you're going to throw away, there's probably some use out there. And during the Great Depression, there were cooperatives that would take people's furniture or lamps or whatever someone could no longer use and fix them and then share them out. So good for you, Gwen. All the best.
Thank you, Gary.
Lincoln from Mount Vernon. Hi, Lincoln. Your turn.
Hey, Gary. How are you?
Good.
Just before I address how I save, I just want to say something because of what you said today related to Gaddafi. There is a big falsehood that's going around that Obama apologized about invading Libya, and it's not true. If you watch the video, what he said was, he said he was sorry for not planning the aftermath of the invasion. That was what he said. And a lot of people in their haste to want to excuse him heard it the way they wanted to hear it. So he actually said, when the interviewer asked him what did he regret most in his presidency, he said, I regret not planning the aftermath of the invasion of Libya. So a lot of people need to be corrected on that, okay?
You are absolutely correct on that, Lincoln. And
yes, I watched the interview.
And what I would like to see happen is, and I'm willing to pay for this, citizen journalists, a group of citizen journalists, to go to Libya and to film people who had been in Libya from different tribes, different backgrounds. There were over 200 different ethnic groups in Libya at the time, and talk about what life was like before the invasion of NATO and subsequent, so that we can put this up on YouTube. We can show the world the truth about Libya, because there are certain moments in life where you have the truth, you got to get it out. And this shows how bankrupt the neoliberal agenda is. It shows how bankrupt the corporate Democrats were, because they were the ones behind it, but Republicans also supported it, to show that we took a person who should not be killed, but look as an example of how that country was being run, because he had stepped out of power long before this. Most people are not aware of that. He wasn't a king. He was a colonel. He never called himself a general. He didn't put medals all over his chest. His country was self-sufficient and self-running. He had over 10,000 local committees, and the committees decided how they would run stuff. They didn't ask. They didn't have to go up high to him or anyone else. And we're clueless about the true history and the way people lived in Libya. And I believe that if you destroy the number one country, because he would have united all of Africa or most of Africa, they would have had their own currency, the gold denier. They'd have been trading. He was going to continue his water project right through Africa. And he had already done more than any of the great wonders of the world. There's no building a project in water that exceeded what Libya did, and it was for the benefit of the Libyan people, but also Algeria and other countries around it. So the true story of Libya has not been told. And citizen journalists, if we can get some qualified citizen journalists, I'll pay for you to go to Libya. I'm going to try to get there. I'm doing multiple documentaries right now, but this would be a documentary we would do on the truth about Libya. All right? Thank you, Lincoln.
And if you ever get a chance, hello?
Yes, I'm here.
You should also do some research on Thomas Sankara of Burkina Faso, because the CIA did the same thing to him that they did to Gaddafi. Thomas Sankara.
I'm fully aware of that, and I mentioned that on last week's show when I was going down all the countries that we have intervened
in.
Oh,
I didn't. I wasn't aware of that because he was one of the people I studied in my life. Okay.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Thank you, Lincoln.
Okay, then.
We're out of time, everyone. Thank you for listening. Look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day.